I so much want to thank Professor Patrick Allett and all of his colleagues in the Voluntary Core program for this invitation. And I also wanted to thank Patrick Allett for this marvelous provocative question as well. It's a big one, whether Eastern Europe is indeed a part of Western civilization. And when he posed the question or suggestion for the talk, I immediately knew what I was going to answer. In a word, my answer is yes, Europe is part of Western civilization, only more so. And the rest of my lecture will be devoted to explaining what I mean by the yes, only more so. One of the first questions to ask is, what is Western civilization? We're all taught in our undergraduate careers how important it is to define our terms. And in this case, what is Western civilization? And this won't come as a shock to you. The primary way of defining Western civilization historically is not a narrow question of geography. Instead, to be part of or participating in Western civilization is more about being in dialogue with the dynamic ideas and historical processes that have shaped Western civilization as a tradition, so that we even can speak of North America or of Australia as being part of Western civilization, even though they're quite remote from old Europe. Beyond this, though, there's the huge and notorious problem of definition of what is and is not Eastern Europe. And that is complicated by the fact that few people in Europe today want to be called Eastern Europeans. Now, personally, I don't mind. I'm of Eastern European ancestry. Professor Allett mentioned, Lithuanian by ancestry. But many people, in fact, do object to that label of Eastern Europe because of the connotations or associations that it carries. Now, definitions of Eastern Europe vary widely, but one that's often accepted is to map or chart a region called Eastern Europe running from Estonia, the northernmost Baltic state in the north, on the chilly shores of the Baltic Sea, and then extending downwards to Bulgaria in the south at the Black Sea. That's some 20 or so countries of tremendous, striking diversity in their language, ethnicity, religion, and history. And we're not talking here about a small region. Today, that's over 150 million people. In a word, Eastern Europe is a region that's marked out as a strategically crucial location. And over the centuries, it's proved to be a very dangerous piece of real estate. As I mentioned, few peoples in the region want to be considered Eastern European. And so as an experiment you could try sometime, if you ask a Hungarian or a Pole or a Czech or a Latvian who they are in these terms, they'll most often tell you that they consider themselves to be Central Europeans. And there's a data point to consider here. Recently, some Lithuanian geographers engaged in a long research project in which they worked to find the central point of the continent. And this involved drawing complicated lines between Portugal and points eastward from Norway all the way down to Greece. And can you guess where they found the center of Europe? In a farmer's field in central Lithuania. And there is the exact spot that they have officially designated as the center of Europe. Hardly anyone wants to be in Eastern Europe because of Eastern Europe's past, which conjures up, with good reason, images of economic backwardness, communist repression, the Iron Curtain, periods of intense fragmentation and violence. Just think of the way in which the word Balkanization is synonymous with disorder and ethnic cleansing. This was a history that was conditioned by geography. The fact that the area was located between massive empires, including the German Empire, the Russian Empire, the Habsburg-Austrian Empire, and the Ottoman-Turkish Empire. So as a result, this area has been fought over and repeatedly divided and full of turmoil. And so it's no wonder that people want to get out from under the label of Eastern Europe. But the thing to keep in mind is that much of this is not about geography, but instead about stereotypes, about perceptions, and about history. And it's summed up in a great joke about Eastern Europe, about two travelers who set off on opposite journeys. One is a Frenchman who climbs aboard a train in Paris, heading towards Moscow. At the exact same moment, a Russian is getting on a train in Moscow, going to Paris. Sometime later, this sounds almost like a math problem, right? Sometime later, the two trains meet, heading in opposite directions in Warsaw, the capital of Poland. And at that point, each of our two travelers looks out, mistakenly thinking that he has reached his final destination. The Russian announces with a great sense of joy, of arrival, "This finally is the West." And at exactly the same moment, the Frenchman is staring out of his train car and experiencing a shiver of fear and saying, "Here I am in the deepest East." What the joke illustrates is that perspectives of East and West are ultimately relative, dependent on one's point of departure, prior assumptions, and expectations. To give a further example of the stereotypes that obtain about Eastern Europe, ask yourself, who are the most famous Eastern Europeans? For those of a certain age, those old enough to remember Rocky and Bullwinkle on Saturday morning cartoons, they include Boris Badenov and his unplaceable Eastern European accent, Natasha Fatale, his collaborator and fearless leader. Or consider, for that matter, a famous literary creation of Count Dracula. I would argue that in spite of the geographic complexities of pinpointing where Eastern Europe is, Eastern Europe can be defined historically as a zone that's been on the front lines throughout the modern period and remains so. Before we move on any further in our discussion of Eastern Europe, however, it might be clarifying to ask, in view of Patrick's excellent question, what's the alternative to Eastern Europe being part of this larger dynamic of Western civilization? So let's for the moment ask ourselves, what if Eastern Europe truly were not part of Western civilization, something set apart? What is it then? Is it utterly outside? Is it utterly foreign to the dynamics and ideas of Western civilization? Is it perhaps always doomed to be a pale imitation of Western civilization, something derivative, something passive, always acted upon and never acting? Is it ultimately the other against which Western civilization might be defined? Now, in fact, these have been views about Eastern Europe. A brilliant book on this subject is written by Larry Wolfe in 1994, entitled Inventing Eastern Europe, and subtitled The Map of Civilization in the Mind of the Enlightenment. Larry Wolfe in this book, which you must read if you have interest about this part of the world, he demonstrates how in earlier centuries, far before the modern period, the imagined dividing line in Europe was not between East and West, but between the frozen barbaric north of places like Germany or Britain, contrasted with the sunny civilized south. That area in which thinkers that you might be reading right now, like Machiavelli, were doing their political acting and their political thinking. In his book, Larry Wolfe masterfully shows how Enlightenment thinkers reconceptualized this set of European contrasts and reoriented Europe, now divided into a civilized West, awash in Enlightenment thought, and a not yet civilized East. And in this tour de force of intellectual history, Larry Wolfe shows how thinkers who might be familiar to you from your voluntary core program, like Voltaire or Rousseau, didn't necessarily visit Eastern Europe in every case, but had ideas about Eastern Europe, theorized about it, and saw Eastern Europe in a durable way as perhaps a playground for Enlightenment ideas, but never fully civilized, always in the process of being civilized thanks to the West. As Professor Allitt pointed out a moment ago, in my own work, I've found it so compelling to examine German ideas about neighboring regions to the East. And in the way in which over the last 200 years, German thinkers, both great and not so great, have thought about Eastern Europe and tried to capture what they saw as its essence. And in many ways, German ideas about Eastern Europe in the modern period have borne striking resemblances to the mythologized Wild West of American experience as well. Here I show a recruiting poster for German volunteers after World War I to stave off the threatening advance of the East in Germany's eastern provinces. So the East could often appear as threatening, disordered, and politically dangerous to Germans in the modern period. But this was in counterpoint with another tradition which saw the East as the land of the future, perhaps Germany's own colonial area of manifest destiny. And here's a poster very suitable to the centenary of the First World War showing a German soldier who is spreading the seed of civilization or culture in an allegedly barbaric Eastern Europe. Stereotypes like these from the West have posited an Eastern Europe that's said to be underdeveloped, violent, unenlightened, and marked by intolerant ethnic nationalism. Well, first of all, let's take those in turn. The notion of underdevelopment is clearly in the eye of the beholder. It depends what you're comparing what to. And we could certainly point to areas in Western Europe that are less developed than some of the places especially marked by industrial civilization in the 19th or 20th centuries. The claim that Eastern Europe has been violent certainly has some basis in fact. These were the bloodlands that gained such notoriety in the middle of the 20th century. The charge that Eastern Europe is unenlightened is part of a longer tradition of seeing parts of Europe as not awash in the Enlightenment. Earlier generations of scholars sometimes claimed that Germany had not experienced Enlightenment, that the Enlightenment had never crossed the Rhine River, and we now know that's nonsense. Certainly now, it's up to historians to point out how the Enlightenment certainly had a tremendous impact on Eastern Europe in the modern period. It's the last one of these stereotypes, though, that I want to take a moment to discuss a little bit further, and it's the contrast between kinds of nationalism, kinds of patriotism or feeling of ethnic belonging. It's said that there are two kinds of nationalism, civic nationalism and ethnic nationalism. The former, civic nationalism, is identified with Western Europe, and ethnic nationalism is said generally to be characteristic of Eastern Europe. Now, you'll immediately sense that these are not value-neutral or objective descriptions. Civic nationalism carries positive connotations. It's said to be based on ideas that are open to all, citizenship, common constitutional values, and a certain openness to newcomers. Ethnic nationalism, by contrast, carries negative connotations. An irreducible identification of people with blood and tribal belonging, a sense of ethnicity that's closed and exclusive. Now, in fact, as often happens in complicated historical realities, historians are pointing out that one needs to think not of these as mutually exclusive binary possibilities, but rather latent possibilities in many kinds of nationalist thinking, whether Eastern or Western, that might coexist in tension with one another, as the historian Aviel Rochwald has argued in his Ethnic Nationalism and the Fall of Empires. Now, while such phenomena of underdevelopment, violence, unenlightenment, and ethnic nationalism are to be seen in Eastern Europe, certainly, they've also been seen in the West as well. So here's the question. How can we find our way to a more nuanced view that captures the character of Eastern Europe and locates it in a truer relation to that larger dynamic of Western civilization? The British journalist and historian Neil Asherson, who's written a lot about Eastern Europe, has an insight, and it's one that I read years ago, but it stayed with me and sunk ever more deeply. And I think this is why we read. This is why we engage in the project of the Voluntary Corps in our own lives in order to find our thinking transformed by a passage from a powerful scholar that really changes our thought fundamentally. In his book, The Struggles for Poland, published back in 1987, what he had to say about Poland was actually broadly applicable to much of Eastern Europe. He wrote, and here I provide just a gloss, "Polish experience has often seemed like the experience of the rest of Europe seen through a looking glass." And Asherson pointed out that for much of Western civilization, the First World War seemed a disaster. For Poland, it brought the regaining of national independence. World War II brought for Poland, not true liberation as for much of Western Europe, but instead the imposition of a new dictatorship, Stalinism. But this is the point that I want to dwell on for a moment. Polish history, Acheson writes, is disconcerting in a second way, because it does strange things to abstract ideas and political isms. In most lands, an ideology hangs over the landscape for a season and then drifts away. In Poland, clouds precipitate in hail, rain, or snow. The results of an idea are all too palpable, visible, and often absurd. And he gives some examples. He points out how ideas of German national identity in the time of Bismarck and the early German Empire produce wounds in beaten school children in Polish territories that are ruled by Germany when they insist on talking their own language. He goes on, the concept of romanticism in figures like Rousseau, whom you might read at some point, in the case of Poland, romanticism means armed men in the forest or chained men in the snow being led off to exile. In Poland, he concludes, ideas crash to earth, and all that is visible is their impact on human lives, more evident in that country than in most. So let's pursue this compelling insight of Acheson's into one other historical case. It's an episode that's largely unknown in the West, even to many specialists, and it is that of a social movement in Lithuania in the second half of the 19th century that unfolded over 40 years in that territory, once part of the Russian Empire. We can then use this particular historical test case as an experiment into validating or invalidating the charge that Eastern Europe's essence is marked by underdevelopment, violence, unenlightenment, and intolerant ethnic nationalism. So first, to set the scene. After the partitions of what had been the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, a new geographic imperial order had been imposed on Eastern Europe. As the territories were split up that had formed Poland, Lithuania, and allotted to the Prussian, Austrian, and Russian empires, the territory inhabited by Lithuanians was split up. Most Lithuanians found themselves behind the border of the Russian Empire, while other Lithuanians found themselves in the territories of East Prussia that came to be sometimes called Lithuania Minor. Today, those of you who know your contemporary geography might know that Lithuania Minor, most of those territories, are part of a strange outpost of the Russian Federation that is split off from the rest of contiguous Russia that is right on the Baltic Sea, the Kaliningrad exclave, which today is surrounded on all sides by NATO members. Now, here's a vivid landscape scene showing this corner of northeastern Europe. At this point, the ruler over most of Lithuania was the Russian Tsar, who ruled in an autocratic fashion. We speak of the Russian Empire, but in the late 19th century, in fact, only 44% of the population of that empire were Great Russians. 56% of the subjects of that empire were non-Russian. And the Lithuanians, in particular, were a peasant people who spoke a very old language in their part of the empire that was quite distinct from Russian. And the peasant entrepreneurs of this people were slowly rising to greater social prominence and challenging what had been a Polish-speaking elite. Now, from the perspective of the Russian Empire, a permanent threat to the security of its new borderlands came from regular Polish and Lithuanian uprisings. Essentially, once every generation, there would be an uprising against Tsarist rule. After the Russian authorities had crushed the Polish-Lithuanian revolt of 1863, they took an especially harsh approach by executing leaders and sending thousands of former rebels into Siberian exile. The Tsar's government increasingly enforced policies that have come to be called Russification, to turn the minorities of the border region into Russians culturally and by language. Now, historians who are often notorious for complicating any perceived reality are very careful to point out in the present day that very often Russification was an improvised policy, not a blueprint or a master plan. But the very policies that later were called Russification touched off a counterreaction, and that's what I want to discuss today. Where did the revolutionary ideas of nationalism opposed to imperial rule come from? Well, in fact, from an Enlightenment thinker who came from this region at the borders of German culture. He's perhaps the most important unknown person of modern times, perhaps more important than Marx, some historians have argued. This is Johann Gottfried Herder, whom one might justly call the father of nationalism and the father of multiculturalism. So we hear much today about diversity and multiculturalism. Herder is where this mode of thought derives from. Herder drew on an Enlightenment romantic conception of each people as being a folk or a nation unto themselves. And the identities of each of these people who contributed something to a gorgeous mosaic of the experience of what it means to be human were most importantly and organically and naturally and providentially expressed in their native languages. This notion of Herder's, that all cultures at some basic level are worthy and equal and part of a providential design, was of enormous significance in Western civilization and in Eastern Europe particularly because of the things he had to say about the richness of Eastern European cultures. His very person confounds the assertion that's sometimes made that you can't be an internationalist nationalist. Some scholars have said that it's an absurdity to think of someone whose ideology is nationalism. They argue you can only be a particular kind of nationalist, a German or a Croatian or an American nationalist. In fact, Herder was an internationalist nationalist. He saw nationalism as the ordering of humanity into a larger design. Motivated by the ideas of Herder, scholars who studied the ethnic landscape of the Baltic region in particular, and many of these scholars were Germans themselves, like Herder, they viewed the Lithuanian language as a language which was ancient, philologically very important, in fact related to Sanskrit in its ultimate Indo-European origins, and they felt the need, from the spirit of Herder, to reach out and to preserve a language that was in the act of dying out. Such German scholars founded what they called the Lithuanian Literary Society in 1873 on the assumption that this language would go extinct in about 50 years and that it was necessary to record it, to fix it, to preserve it when no one in the future would speak that language. And they had reasons for thinking this because the ancient Prussian language, the language of a Baltic tribe who had lived to the south of the Lithuanians, they'd been wiped out and their very name had been taken over by the German crusaders who had supplanted them. So there was a precedent for going extinct. This then is the background for the astonishing social movement that I want to discuss with you today. A movement involving people like this, a man carrying a heavy backpack. And this social movement in the second half of the 19th century produced scenes like this. Let me start this way. Not very originally, but certainly dramatic. It was a dark and stormy night. A lot like last night, in fact. And that's weather that is ideal for smugglers. Because the moon isn't to be seen, there's little light. It's ideal for crossing the river that lies between East Prussia in Germany and the Russian Empire, a river that marks the border. It's ideal weather for men who are heavily burdened with packs to slip across the river and then scuttle into the woods that lie on the Russian side of the border. Woods of pine, of ghostly birch trees, and of ancient oaks. These are men carrying bundles full of smuggled goods. As they continue making their way into the territory of the Russian Empire, they need to be careful because there are actually three heavily guarded lines of border patrols that lie between them and the point they need to reach. They're glad of the fact that they don't need to travel far into the interior of the Russian Empire. They just need to make it to particular distribution points that have been set up in advance behind the border region, inns, in some cases, the house of the local priest, in order to deliver their smuggled goods, which, of course, raises the question, what are they carrying? They're not carrying brandy. They're not carrying tobacco that has evaded tax. Instead, their sacks are full of books, illegal books. This is the story of the book smuggling movement of Lithuania of the second half of the 19th century. The Tsar's officials had reacted to the revolution that had just failed in a way that backfired in an astonishingly broad way. The Tsarist authorities had reacted to the revolution by banning printing of Lithuanian in its usual Roman alphabet that had been brought from the Poles and the Germans, instead insisting on works like this, which if you look closely is not in the Latin alphabet, but in the Cyrillic Russian alphabet. The expectation of these officials was that if Lithuanians could be transitioned to this different alphabet, the result would be that they would generally be brought closer to Russian culture over time, moved away from Polish influence, which was seen as politically radical and revolutionary. This attempt at ethnic manipulation also had religious implications, because for the Lithuanian population, which was generally Roman Catholic, their prayer books and literature on religious topics was a substantial part of all of the printed material circulating in Lithuania at the time. And the officials understood this. Their long-term expectation was that the population would thus slowly be moved towards conversion to Russian Orthodoxy as the faith of the Tsars. This ban, this so-called press ban, was in effect from 1864 to 1904, so for 40 years. And there's no way around this central fact. It proved a huge disaster because it provoked a widespread social mobilization involving thousands of people over four decades. Book smugglers like this man, Jurgis Bielinis, who went by a nickname he was very proud of, the king of the book smugglers, was instrumental in moving books on a vast scale that were printed on the other side of the border in Germany's province of East Prussia, where there was a large Lithuanian minority, and helping, along with many other assistants, moving these books across the border to the Russian territory. One way in which the book smugglers complicated life even further for the Russian authorities was when they printed books on the German side of the border, they would sometimes take that first page, which gives today the copyright information, then the publication information, and they would falsify the date or the place where this book had been published in order to make it seem that the book had been grandfathered in because a book had been published in a time when using Latin alphabet was still acceptable and legal. So as you can imagine, librarians, this is a nightmare for them, right? Because how do you correctly catalog a book when it has deliberately been falsified in its publication information? Not all smugglers were like Bielinis in being motivated by a love of literature or a love of their religious identity. Some were simply former smugglers who used to smuggle other things. And now, suddenly, as the book trade got going, the illegal book trade, the result was that some of them would, for motives that were completely not idealistic, would engage in this as a very lucrative trade, replacing one that they earlier had a lot of experience in. On the Russian side of the border, a vast network grew up of supporters of this underground movement who helped to distribute the books widely. And this could range very high up the social scale. The bishop, Motiejus Valančius, who was bishop of the Lithuanian lowlands, engaged in a secret life on the side, in addition to his formal official religious duties, by helping create networks for the distribution of these religious books. Another role that deserves to be specially brought out is the role of women in this movement, who played key roles, as did these women, Zaunuti and Bortkavicieni, in the publishing of secret newspapers and their distribution on the Russian side of the border. Eventually, over the course of the decades that this movement became ever more elaborate, things got to the point where every small town in the country had its supply, regular supply, of illegal books that were flowing in. Over the 40 years of this ban, nearly 3,000 book smugglers were arrested by the Tsarist authorities and punished. And we can't be exactly sure of how many more were never caught. If one was caught carrying books over the border police would immediately beat the person and then haul him off, usually him, to jail, and a sentence to a term in Siberian exile of 3 to 5 years. So that could certainly be a significant punishment. If someone was in the act of being apprehended and they ran, they were simply shot on the spot. Over time, this movement also changed its character. At first, it had a religious focus, but over time, this underground press moved to focus more on political aims and a wider range of ideas. Here is a long list of the confiscated books that come from the Tsarist archives. Here is already moving beyond the religious focus of the initial movement is a modern political newspaper published in East Prussia but distributed in Lithuania on the Tsarist side of the border. By 1904, it was clear to the Tsar's officials that what they had intended by this policy had failed, and in fact, it had produced the opposite effect. And so in 1904, the ban is called off. Astonishingly, the Lithuanian language, which experts earlier had warned would soon be extinct, actually underwent a remarkable revival in defiance of the government as a result of the book ban. And we can only speculate what would have happened if the book ban had not taken place and unleashed this unexpected reaction. You remember I talked about that German society that aimed to preserve Lithuanian, like preserving butterflies behind glass. By 1923, they shut down because it was clear that the country of Lithuania that represented the speakers of this language was actually on its way to building an independent state rather than going extinct. So as we end, let's return to the test that we were going to run on this historical episode. And that was the supposition that Eastern Europe's essence is marked in some characteristic way by underdevelopment, violence, unenlightenment, and intolerant ethnic nationalism. The question of underdevelopment, as I pointed out earlier, here is complex. Even though this was a less industrialized part of Europe, here, however, was a growing civil society, defying the imperial government, the growth of what historians call a public sphere. As for violence, the verdict is quite clear. On the contrary, in the case of the book smuggling movement, here we had both a mass mobilization involving thousands and yet remarkable for being massive but non-violent. Regarding the charge that the Enlightenment and its ideas never made it to Eastern Europe, in fact, this movement was a product of Enlightenment ideas that derived from Herder about preserving your language, preserving your identity, and survival of a people. And finally, it was not an expression of purely narrow ethnic nationalism, but rather had a linguistic emphasis. And a linguistic emphasis on nationalism can also be discriminatory, but it also can be open to participation by others. And it's this that I want to close with. A strange minor historical episode that grew out of the movement I've talked about, a fascinating case of changed identity. And this is most appropriate for folks like yourselves who are reading in the Voluntary Corps. It shows, in the case of one individual, how engagement with texts and with language can change you utterly. It's the case of this man, Georg Sauerwein, or as he went by among Lithuanians, Jurgis Sauerweinas, which is just the same name, but with Lithuanian grammar and Lithuanian endings tacked on. Sauerwein was a remarkable, astonishing polyglot scholar of German descent, who in spite of being German, ardently identified himself with the rebirth of Lithuanian culture. He was born in Hanover, he studied at Göttingen, and he later earned a living by translating scripture for the British Bible Society. He must have been an astonishing person to meet because it's said that he spoke some 40 languages. One estimate, however, suggests that he may have been able to work his way through about 200 languages when it come right down to it. In his interest in Lithuanian as an ancient language which had a lot of philological and linguistic insights because of its antiquity, he had forerunners, those German scholars who thought that Lithuanian soon would be going extinct. He made a short visit to the Prussian part of Lithuania in the 1870s and learned the language of the region quickly, and then did something which scholars are not supposed to do, which is to become active in the political organization of that cultural revival. Even though he settled in Norway, he returned every summer to this region and organized delegations, petitions to the government, and even stood for election as a candidate. He tended to speak for 3 hours at a time, and that may be why he didn't win this election. That wasn't a very popular thing to do. But he did something very interesting in all of his activism. Increasingly, he identified himself with the Lithuanians he was talking about. He would start preaching to them, writing exhortations that they had to preserve their language. In part, he said, this was a religious duty. If God gave you your language, it needs to be preserved. He expressed his dismay with the Germanization policies pursued by the imperial government from the later 1870s and criticized, as a German, that concept of German culture or identity fiercely. In 1898, he wrote a poem which strikes me as both very revealing and very bizarre. And here's a part of the poem. In that poem, he wrote that he had long, long dreamt that I am a Lithuanian. Around me, I saw the kin with the eyes of the soul. So did it seem to me lofty, honorable, and dear, end quote. The lasting imprint of his writings was left on the national movement, which in particular, one piece of his writing that came to be the unofficial second national anthem of Lithuania. And it runs, and as I read you these words, keep in mind constantly that the author is actually German by origin. The words run like this. Lithuanians we are born, Lithuanians we want to be, we receive that honor at our birth, and we must not let it perish. Over 100 years later, in our own times, Zauerweinas' anthem is deeply entrenched in Lithuanian national tradition. It gets sung on a regular basis. But it's also remarkable to observe how it also has sometimes been misremembered, how on occasion it's been corrected or amended. In many popular renderings, it's quoted incorrectly as, Lithuanians we are born, Lithuanians we must be, as if it's an ethnic definition. Zauerweinas' words had been, Lithuanians we are born, Lithuanians we want to be. Thus, this correction, in quotation marks, entirely revises the earlier stress on wanting that identity, voluntarism, and it turns the words in the direction, in our own times, of a greater ethnic nationalism. And sometimes, adding insult to injury, people also misremember who wrote that song. They sometimes misattribute it to another contemporary of Zauerweinas, a Lithuanian author by the name of Kudirka. And as is often the case, such historical mistakes are highly significant. So we can conclude, I think, at the end, that Eastern Europe is most definitely a part of the process of Western civilization, as this historical case indicated. And I want to close with reference to the present day to show how topical this is now. This has to do with where we are at the present. After the fall of the Berlin Wall, given the diverse nature of Eastern Europe, many of the best and keenest and most insightful contemporary commentators and journalists confidently predicted after the fall of communism that Eastern Europe would revert to intense ethnic clashes and warfare. They argued, with historical precedent, that communist regimes had in fact repressed nationalism and they'd brought order to Eastern Europe, even if that were a gray and impoverished order. And indeed, between the world wars, Eastern European countries had often been at each other's throats with intense border disputes. So what did happen after the fall of the wall? The predictions of violence, unfortunately, did come true for Yugoslavia, where wars raged for a decade. But they did not, fortunately, come true for Central and Northern Eastern Europe. And this proved to a great measure to be due to an enlightened policy by Polish leaders, as explained in Timothy Snyder's The Reconstruction of Nations. Instead of raising territorial disputes with neighbors, Polish diplomats worked to join the European Union and NATO, and then worked to help neighboring countries do so as well. And this is a pleasant surprise to register international affairs where such cooperation is unfortunately quite rare. But I would say that at the present, there's an hour of test that's upon the world, because new plans for partition are being enacted in Europe today on the territory of Ukraine. In 2008, Vladimir Putin is reported to have said that Ukraine is not really a country. It's artificial and something that needs to be abolished as a reality. And now, in our own times, pieces of Ukraine are being carved off by armed force. And so the question raises itself, is this likely to be the tenor of what follows? Is this the new normal? Alas, Eastern Europe has had lots of historical precedents for partitions, invasions, and territorial wars. But as I hope I've made clear, it also has other traditions as well of united action, of peaceful social movements, and more positive models of coexistence. I read on your website of the Voluntary Corps a statement that I fully agree with, that a liberal education is liberating. You could also say that a liberal education is also obligating, in the sense that it forces us to ask questions that have implications for our own future. And where we are now represents such a significant, perhaps existential question. We've seen that Eastern Europe is part of Western civilization, as are we, and thus it concerns us all, and that's what's being tested today. Thank you very much for your attention.
Dr. Liulevicius will be happy to take your questions.
Please.
Would you consider Turkey to be part of Eastern Europe, either like culturally or geographically, or something entirely different?
So I'll give you a Weasley answer that's that of a historian. It's certainly an Eastern European player. Was your question about whether it's part of Eastern Europe?
Or? Yeah, is Turkey part of Eastern Europe in your definition?
Well, I mean, Turkey obviously is not monolithic, and there's a lot of different groups and experiences that have gone into the shaping of Turkey. I'd say that Turkey has definitely been a player in Eastern European history. And in terms of shaping the cultures of the Balkans, that's been a huge impact. So I would vote in favor. I would vote yes for a more inclusive definition. Thank you, please.
Do you have any comments on the transition from the early 20th century Pan-Slavism within Russia to contemporary far-right Russian discussions of Eurasian identity in opposition to the sort of Slavic or European notion of Russia?
Yeah. Well, that's an excellent question, and it shows just how closely you've been following some of the intellectual currents that in many cases have historical roots dating back centuries. I think that right now the far right represents a grab bag rather than an intellectually rigorous narrative of historical development. To my mind, the Pan-Slavists, in some sense, and a Pan-Slavist wouldn't like to hear this probably, also have a debt to some of the thought that I was talking about here today. The notion of Herder in particular, who in a famous chapter in his Universal History on the Slavs, talked about the Slavs as having an ethnic character that set them apart. And Herder idealized them for rhetorical purposes, speaking of the Slavs as essentially peaceful, a wrong people, and also a people of immense potential. So they would sign off on all of this. To the extent that Pan-Slavism is rooted in a romantic impulse, they owe a debt to Western intellectual tradition that they themselves would probably not want to acknowledge. The claim that Russia is entirely apart and is not part of Western civilization, advanced by some of the Eurasianist thinkers, I think historically is very dubious. It's probably more in the category of an idealized self-image that serves political uses in the present rather than anything resembling a responsible historical analysis. But that doesn't mean that it's not powerful for some people. Absolutely. Thank you. Please.
Historically, what role does the schism between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church play
plays a huge role. I mean, that's an excellent question. The lines of religious difference track very closely with lines of conflict. And Samuel Huntington, when he talked about clashes of civilizations, was gesturing at the religious significance of some of these dividing lines. And yet, historians who love the difficult cases, the cases of ambiguity, would point out the frequency of instances of seemingly effortless coexistence. So in these regions, you have the blending of different varieties of Orthodox believers coexisting with other communities, like Jewish communities, like Catholic communities, very frequently without apocalyptic scenarios coming to pass. And so I think one of the things that's characteristic of Eastern Europe is precisely the multilingual, multi-ethnic, day-to-day experience of people in the periods that I was just talking about today, the way in which people would seemingly effortlessly speak one language at home, another language in their place of worship, yet another language in the marketplace, without this seeming abnormal. On the contrary, I think that limiting oneself to just one language or a narrowing of those options, that's probably historically less the rule. So in this case, though, that of the book smuggling, the religious implications were front and center. And very little progress was made in among Lithuanians in terms of a conversion to Orthodoxy. So attempts at this kind of manipulation probably frequently backfire across this divide.
So
is now, right?
Yeah. Well, in terms of nation building, you know, the bolstering of civil society, and just circling back a bit on how you're, you know, talking about, you know, despite the political and conceptual barriers of the transfer of the Western ideas to Eastern Europe, I'm curious to know if, you know, if the opposite occurred, you know, transfer of some distinctly Eastern intellectual ideas to Europe as the
First of all, that's an excellent question. And I think that talking about the 19th century is exciting, will win the approval of your own Professor Vic very readily and my own. There's a certain drama, right, to the project of nation building that clearly captivated some great minds and some restless spirits. Your question about the flow of ideas from the East prompts this reaction. I think that Herder, in particular, forms some of his key ideas about nationalism, what is a nation, when he's working as a pastor in what is today Latvia, in Riga, in the Russian Empire. And he forms some of his ideas like about things that we take for granted today, like folklore and folk music. It comes from Herder's thought. His inspiration came from observing these peoples in Eastern Europe. So I would class Herder as a thinker whose ideas have a certain Eastern European vintage. But then when you look at later in the 19th century, Russian authors, the great Russian novelists, Russian poetry of Pushkin, these things are readily, there are waves of enthusiasm for them in Germany and in the rest of the Western world as representing another mode of being, another mode of thinking or of feeling, and accessible through, in some cases, their romanticism. I'd also make the argument that because that Russia also makes a particular contribution to Western thought and feeling in the exciting 19th century, as you put it, because of the ardor and the ferocity of its revolutionary tradition. Russian populists and social revolutionaries engage in a running battle with the Tsarist government and sometimes in spectacular acts of terrorism. And this really appeals and leaves a really deep impact on certain European revolutionary thinkers in places far afield like Spain or Germany. So I think that this is one of the aspects of Western civilization I think is characteristic of it, is that it's not focused in on itself exclusively and its own canonical works, but there's a readiness, an eagerness, a sense of the necessity of drawing inspiration from outside, sampling those other literatures, and incorporating their insights. So there's probably many other examples, but those are the ones that come to mind right now. Please.
Yeah. I don't want to put you on the spot, autobiographic, but you're part of the Lithuanian diaspora. Presumably part of it. How has that shaped your own insights into what it means to be Eastern European? I'm just thinking of a few years ago, I was in Milwaukee, and it was actually Oktoberfest, and I was struck that Oktoberfest, which is, of course, a quintessentially German event, that there were Poles, and there were the Czechs, and probably, I don't know if there's what the Lithuanian community in Milwaukee is, but I
they were there. I'm certain they were there.
Yeah. And they were all a part of it. They all participated and then sort of blended. And I thought, this is interesting. But if you don't mind.
No, I'd be glad to. That's a very sensitive, in a good way, question that you pose. I think that, I guess, from my perspective, perhaps too limited an individual, I would argue that the experience of exile, the experience of displacement. My parents and grandparents came over as refugees after the Second World War, after being in displaced persons camps in Germany for several years, fleeing the imposition of Stalinist control in their home country. I'd argue that in our world today, those experiences are looking more and more universal and looking more and more common, without being quite the same, right? I mean, our experience of today of accelerated movement, of finding yourself in a cultural situation that you might be unfamiliar with, it, and then being shocked that you find ways of coming to terms with it, that you find a way of carving out a life, whether your movement is for economic or political or personal reasons, that this is part of what it means to be contemporary. At the same time, I think that in modern history and probably pre-modern history, these experiences were often quite common. I think of the Irish, for instance, where great portions of their own narrative about themselves take place outside of Ireland, right? For reasons that have everything to do with the storms of history as well as individual choice. I'm thankful that historical fate allowed me the opportunity to speak with you here today. I guess it shows you how hard it is to predict the trajectories of individual lives. I don't know if that goes some way towards answering your excellent question. Please.
So your mention of Wolf, I think, is really a key point to all of this and speaks to the way that Western civilization folks like to other folks, right? In such a way that they might find it surprising to read Lolita in Tehran, right? Or that, you know, these universal ideas might have very, very powerful impact. So when you see, you know, and by the way, thank you for your scholarly works. They really taught me a lot about Eastern Europe, and I'm a Russian, so, you know, don't always see everything through the Russian perspective that way. But I thought one of the interesting things that Snyder has argued, and I'd like you to see if you can respond to this, is that that very mosaic that you're talking about that inspired Herder, and not only Herder, right, lots of other people, was deliberately murdered in the early 20th century with these vast acts of ethnic genocide and ethnic deportations, and have created a fraught situation for even these 25 years where people are trying to figure out how we avoid those terrible, terrible times, right? But yet are lacking, if you look at the multicultural much stronger west of the Berlin Wall than it is east of the Berlin Wall, right? And that has a lot to do with what happened after World War II, what happened during World War II. So I don't know if I'm being very articulate on this.
No,
you've
been entirely articulate. The first thing I would maybe in a friendly way challenge the notion that the othering that Wolf writes about so eloquently is exclusively characteristic of Western civilization. I fear that this is a human quality, and that one could write many such books about the experiences of many confident cultures that have had really devastating and unkind things to say about their neighbors. So that's just a pessimistic note to begin with. And you're entirely right. The legacy of the ethnic cleansing and the genocide that what Snyder calls the Bloodlands have seen leaves work for historians and work for societies and for individuals and families that's going to last centuries. And ultimately, I don't think you can't repair a situation like that. I think the best one can do, tragically, is to do justice to the historical past by representing it in its full reality, rather than purveying simplified and reductionist narratives. I'm actually optimistic on this score, because several generations now of younger historians who are working in multiple languages and are publishing in English and in German are doing some astonishing work, especially dealing with some of the most sensitive and fraught and painful episodes of the communities that they belong to themselves. And that gives me great hope, because it rescues from oblivion an actual recording of, as a famous German historian said, wie es eigentlich gewesen, as it really was. To me, this is another key moment, because there are oral histories that could still be captured in the next 10 years that are better than what we'll have 10 years from now. So it's a very urgent task, I think, for intellectuals. And it strikes me that many of the younger historians in particular are stepping up to that task. And that's perhaps a source of hope. They're worrying and what's the right word? Not allowing the society at large, by addressing society at large about, let's say, the cityscapes of Eastern Europe. And the way in which people are walking across areas where the large Jewish communities were cruelly dispossessed and then wiped out, to remember this, to find ways of memorializing that becomes urgent. And that's a way, I think, of moving societies towards a recognition of their past that's very necessary. So I have some hope on that score.
Questions of time compels to stop now. If you're a member of one of the voluntary core classes, remember to sign out as you leave, and please now join me in thanking our speakers.
Thank you.